I am amazed at how quickly fruit flies appear in my house when fruit is overripe. I decided to put this piece of a fig near the fruit flies for a few hours so that they could lay their eggs on it, and then I would be able to see what the eggs look like and watch them develop into flies. The flies did not like me shining a light and camera at them, so they flew away every time I tried to film them. I never saw them lay eggs. This was one of the few flies who remained on the fig long enough for me to film it. Maybe this one didn't fly away because it was so fat. Or do they all have such big bellies? They also have very short antennas. The next morning, I found that the fig was covered with hundreds of white eggs. Unlike most eggs, these eggs have two long white tubes protruding from them. Somehow the tubes provide the eggs with oxygen. These eggs are laid in wet, fermenting fruit, and apparently they need to breathe. To protect the eggs from predators and dehydration, I put the small, round container that held the fig into this rectangular plastic container, and I kept the lid shut. The eggs were not laid in any particular order. They were scattered at random. However, they all tended to have the two white tubes pointing upwards. The eggs are white, but some of them look red or purple because they have fig juice on them. Here is an egg on my fingertip. They are about the size of a grain of salt. Unless you looked closely, you would assume that the fig has been sprinkled with salt or sugar. The next day, some of the eggs had hatched into tiny larvae. These creatures have an incredibly short life cycle. The larvae are almost completely transparent and difficult to see. On the following day, there were hundreds of larvae, and by this time the fig was starting to liquefy. The larvae were swimming around in the fig juice. The eggs were sinking into the liquid, but the tips of those two tubes seemed to float, thereby preventing the eggs from completely submerging in the liquid. The larvae appear to be drinking the fig juice, but science books say that they are eating the yeast and other microorganisms that live in the juice, but I haven't found an explanation for how they can eat microscopic creatures. Maybe they are like whales that can filter tiny organisms. The larvae have two tubes running from the tip of their tail all the way to their head. At their tail, the two tubes protrude slightly. They tend to keep their tail at the surface of the liquid, apparently because those two protrusions are providing them with oxygen, and the two tubes are delivering the oxygen throughout their body. Here is a larva and two eggs that I took out of the fig and put into some water. The light is shining underneath them. The purple spot is a piece of the fig. In my other videos that show insect eggs, you can see the creatures developing inside the egg, but these fruit fly eggs never show anything inside. These eggs don't seem to have a yolk or embryo, but since the larva is transparent, I suppose whatever is inside the egg is also transparent. Here is a view of the fig from the side. The larva frequently changed locations by crawling along the surface rather than swimming underneath the liquid. Here are two tubes of the eggs sticking above the surface. At their head, they have two tiny dark spots, which I suppose are primitive eyes. The next day, the larvae were a bit larger and more developed. Here is one in water. Its internal organs are starting to become visible. Here is a side view of the fig. When the larvae are not traveling around, this is their typical position. Their heads are normally submerged inside the fermenting fruit, and all that you see are the two protrusions that stick out of their tail. Somehow, those two tubes are transferring oxygen into the larva. In this position, they are almost completely hidden from predators. Here is a larva that is poking its head out of the fig. The two dark spots might be eyes. Its mouth has some type of dark, rake-like structure. When looking at the fig from the side, you can see larvae poking their head or tail above the surface every few seconds. When looking at the fig from a distance, it makes it appear as if the surface is alive or bubbling. This piece of fig is only as large as my fingertip, but there seem to be hundreds of larvae living in it. And all of the larvae are growing larger every day. If all they eat are microorganisms, there must be an enormous quantity of microorganisms in order to feed this many larvae. After another day, the larvae became larger, and their internal organs became much easier to see. Here is a group of them, all of which have their tails sticking just above the surface. Each of those double yellow dots is the tip of their tail. They are living at an incredible density. To prevent the fig from drying out, I occasionally added a drop or two of water, but I never added any microorganisms for them to eat. The larvae now have a lot of tubes running through their body, as you can see as this one crawls over the others. The fig must be filling up with their waste products, but it doesn't seem to be bothering them. I never saw any dead larvae. Here is a larva that I put into water. These older larvae show a lot of internal organs and tubes. Meanwhile, back at the fig, the larvae are about 4 days old. That is not very old, but these creatures grow at an incredible rate. They are about ready to turn into cocoons. Perhaps they would develop even faster if they did not have to live in such extreme population density. I found one cocoon on the fourth day. I put it in water to wash it off. At the tail are the two protrusions, and at the head is something even stranger. It looks like antennae, but they don't seem to connect to anything. They look like fingers or the roots of a plant, but I have never seen them attached to anything. You can see the larva inside the cocoon. Those two black spots are its eyes, and the black spot in front is the mouth. The upper part of the cocoon is empty. This cocoon was twice the size of the others that I found later, so maybe this one came from a different type of fruit fly. Or maybe this larva got more food than the others. These cocoons matured very quickly. The next day you could see red eyes, black wings, and the V-shaped lines of the legs. After another day, many of the larvae had turned into cocoons. The fig was now turning brown, and soon it became black. Many of the larvae became cocoons at the surface of the black, rotten fig, but many others crawled out of the inner plastic container and turned into cocoons inside the larger, rectangular container. The quantity of cocoons was incredible. By this time, there were also lots of small, clear worms crawling everywhere. I have never figured out where these worms come from, or what creatures they turn into. I find these worms in my sink drains also. They are too small and transparent to see clearly. These three cocoons are attached to the outer rectangular container. The next day, one of them had already hatched. They can hatch without destroying their cocoon. The reason is because the head of the cocoon has a flap that opens up, allowing the fly to crawl out. I never saw one hatch, but there were a couple that got stuck in the hatching process, such as this one. The flap has opened up, and you can see his eyes and head, but he can't get out for some reason. I'll poke the flap with a needle to show you where it is. Here is another fly that got stuck partway out of its cocoon. Its wings did not completely form. Apparently, his body is stuck to the cocoon. Since these flies do not like being filmed, the easiest way to study them is to find one of these defective flies that cannot move. You can see that it has two short, hairy antennae. Like a lot of flies, it also has three translucent eyes in the top center of its head. And here is a close-up of its right antenna and its left antenna.